Make some noise for Rep. Oh, yay. That's a fact. This is definitely Chocolate City, man. We in Chocolate City right now. Is DC in the building right now? True indeed. We happy to have you here. We're going to have some fun a little later. I'm going to keep this show moving along. Is anybody that was a part of it or is a part of NSBE in the building? National Society of Black Engineers? Nobody? Either way, this is a very important group, and we're going to have a conversation with the CEO of NSBE in just a moment here. So, go ahead. You can clap it up for the CEO of NSBE. Clap it up for the CEO of NSBE real quick. It's early. Y'all still waking up, but I love it, though. We glad to see y'all here. All right, so our next speaker understands that effective leadership begins with having a servant's heart. Throughout her years, she's used her life experiences, exposure, and commitment to service to do the work that changes lives and communities all over the world. You can see through her work at General Electric, Wikipedia, NSBE, and even the White House that she comes in peace, but she means business. So let's give some peace, love, and a resounding welcome for the CEO of NSBE, Janeen Uzzell.
Oh boy.
And to moderate the panel, we have from the Washington Post, Mr. Mike Howard.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hey.
How's
Happy
it going?
Happy Friday.
We made it, y'all. We're going to open this fancy water. Thank you for this. Welcome, everyone. Uzzell. Janeen Uzzell. Hello. Welcome.
Thank you for getting it right.
Yeah, so, you know, I know we just mentioned a little bit about your experience and everything. I want to say hello to everyone. Again, I'm Mike Howard. I am a recruiting operations and programs lead at the Washington Post. So that's just a fancy way of saying I help with our operations on our employer branding team. So you'll be meeting some of our team here. I see some of my team in the audience. Come and check us out at our expo booth today. So it's really good to see everyone. And as well, I want to now introduce Janeen again. It's really, really a big deal that you are this first CEO of the National Society of Black Engineers. Can you tell us? Yes, let's clap for that.
No, shout out to me.
Yeah.
This is not easy.
Tell us a little bit about the significance of that and, you know, what that means to you.
Well, I'm going to start with the fact that I'm a product of NSBE. You know, we are the largest ecosystem of Black STEM talent and thought leadership student-led organization. I used to be a member of NSBE class of a long time ago when I was at North Carolina A&T, Aggie Pride.
Aggie Pride?
Not one Aggie in the house. That's okay. And so I came through NSBE and then spent about 20 years at GE. I'm a mechanical engineer by training, and my background and the work that I've done has always been around access to healthcare. My team and I were responsible for handheld ultrasound and making it solar powered and then using it in adjudicated communities where I worked mostly in Africa, India, parts of the world like that. So there's a lot of technology around what it means to reverse engineer a product, and there's not a lot of Black women that are mechanical engineers that do that work. And then I had a chance to be COO at Wikipedia, so if any of y'all saw me having like a serious emotional moment with these Black women over here, it's because we used to work together at Wikipedia. If y'all want to know what really happens behind the scenes of one of the top five websites in the world, listen, we're the Black folks that can tell you a little bit about it. So I had a chance to run Wikipedia for many, many years and to really do the work during, particularly during the Black Lives Matter movement, because that happened to be the time when I was there, and working on maintaining the efficacy and the uptime of that type of a platform, working through the disinformation movement of the person that was running for president at that time, whose name we don't speak, right? And then also working through so many of the challenges on that platform. And then right when I thought I was coming to kind of the end of my career, I have an opportunity to go back and to lead NSBE. and to bring us into what I consider to be a very pivotal moment for Black organizations, Black people, turning 50, building this legacy of a community, and continuing to really fill the world with talent in technology that is Black, mm-hmm. because we need more of that. Most importantly, the issues of the world today are all related to technology, and they're steeped in technology. And if we don't have people that look like us in this community or in this world building it, then the technology, as you know, is just as biased as the people that are building and driving it. And so we're committed to continuing to grow the pipeline, the community. I really don't like the word pipeline, but building up the community of tech. We start from the third grade all the way through high school. Then you have your collegiate community. And our mission is to create culturally responsible Black engineers, you know, who excel academically, succeed professionally, and positively impact the community. So we are a social justice movement.
Yeah.
We started in 1975 on the heels of the Black Power movement by some brothers at Purdue University. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're here making moves in tech. Most yeah. recently, we moved our conference from Florida. I guess you can guess why. And that was not easy. We left money on the table and we walked away. And it's a pinch to us financially, but it's the right thing to do. And fortunately, we'll be in Atlanta. That has welcomed us with open arms. You know, the mayor of Atlanta is a NSBE member, alum, and so we'll take 15,000 Black folks to Atlanta, and we'll just do our thing there.
Nice, nice. You know, something we spoke about is that you were appointed by President Biden, and you serve as an advisor on the board of directors of Historically Black College and Universities. I myself am a HBCU alum. I graduated from Hampton University. Shout out to the Pirates. I don't know if we have any Hamptonians in the building. But tell me a little bit about the significance of that. What does that mean to you, and how have you been able to make an impact there?
Well, truly, I mean, it's an honor to serve the president, mm-hmm. to serve the vice president, and to serve the HBCUs as a graduate. As someone who served on the board of A&T for the College of Engineering, as a Black woman that has the privilege and the financial means to have started an endowment at her school, it's just super important to me to be able to do this work. The president is making very, very intense financial commitments to HBCUs, and we're focused on infrastructure, ensuring that the historical buildings continue to stand. Mm-hmm. It's very important that we focus on what's happening with this SCOTUS vote and, you know, affirmative action. I was on a panel yesterday talking about how this affects us. And there's two ways that it affects HBCUs. Let me just say this real quick. If you're at a PWI and now this affirmative action role inhibits your ability to matriculate, to have money to go to school there, and to have a successful education. And if you're in tech, it's a super, super expensive education. Now, if you're at an HBCU, for those of you that have been to HBCUs, you may recall those are the schools that were created for us because we couldn't go to the PWIs. So the very institutions that were created for us to be able to have an education, we are now the minorities, particularly in the tech space. So if you're in the College of Engineering, the College of Computer Science, at an HBCU, more than likely, you are now the minority, and the majority of those students are Asian, Indian, and white. Because folks know we have quality education and great schools, and they're sending their kids there. But what that means is that our students now also cannot get money to go to HBCUs. This is the biggest mess I have ever seen. Hmm. We cannot get money to go to the PWIs, and then we cannot get money to go to the schools that were created for us. So we have a serious, serious crisis on our hands, because what it does is it squeaks us right out of the educational movement, and we have to, you know, have these degrees to some extent to work in this space.
Yeah.
So we're focused heavily on debt relief. I know some of you may think that that it's not happening, but it really is, I guarantee you the next time they open the window, please fill out the paperwork. I'm watching people's debt get relieved day in and day out. So it really is happening. And we're focusing on scholarships and funding and ways that we can help. So it's a very important role, and it ties directly into what I do at NSBE.
Yeah.
But it's something that I'm very passionate about because, you know, I had an opportunity to go to school. I had an opportunity to go to an HBCU. Mm-hmm. And I had an opportunity to graduate with no debt.
Yeah. That's a perfect segue into my next section here, where I want you to, you know, dive a little bit deeper into, you know, what your vision for NSBE is now coming in as CEO, and what, how, you know, how that vision, how you hope to bring that vision to life.
So I'm about 2.5 years into my role, and I think the first thing we needed to do was get us back into a space of convening post-COVID. So the first thing we had to do was get the organization relaunched from a space where we gather. Our national convention is the largest convening of blacks in STEM. And so bringing us back to life in that sense was critical. Bringing our summer engineering experience for kids back. This is a program that we offer for free for third, fourth, and fifth graders. And then we do a separate program just for girls in the fifth grade. Because if you read the research, studies will show that girls around the fifth grade, we have a heavy competition with social media and what seems to be cool and where they feel like they can ask the right questions and just thrive. And so we've created a separate program in partnership with a group called Tech Bridge Girls. And we're focused on taking these students through this 3-week program. It is free. We've been doing the program so long now that we're actually seeing the longitudinal study that we've done shows students that have gone through the program and are now graduating from college. We're talking to mothers that have taken their kids maybe, you know, out of the south side of Chicago, put them into our summer program, and then run them through NSBE for all of these years. So getting those programs back into our communities, we host one here in DC as well, is really important. And then really getting NSBE over the hump of turning 50, because it's not just turning 50, it's securing the legacy for the next 50 years.
Yeah.
To ensure that we can continue to grow the black space of tech. I've been focused on introducing new models of funding. We have a strong desire from our membership to learn more about entrepreneurship, so being in places like this is really important. And then bringing people like IO in this community to our conference so that our students can meet and have these conversations and know that you don't necessarily have to go the traditional path. As a mechanical engineer, I went through a very traditional path. You know, I worked at GE, had a great career there, did a lot of round, machining and mechanics. But that's not the future that's built for everyone. Mm-hmm. And so having them meet people like you all and engage in conversations like this is important.
Yeah. First of all, can you guys give yourselves a hand, first of all. You know, to your point, coming to events like this, you mentioned like this is something that NSBE is making a commitment toward,
right,
over the next few years. How can we encourage attendees to explore NSBE for career resources and that sort of deal as they start going out here and making sure that they're growing their career in STEM?
So there are a couple of things that are really important. Whether you have children, you're an auntie, you have god kids, you might have one or two kids you like, I don't know, just whatever it is.
Yeah.
For any young person that's a part of your life, first and foremost, you know, there's this wellness check that we do on our people all the time. You okay? You've been to the doctor? How's your blood pressure? You know, put the pork rinds down. We need to start talking to our community about what are the classes your kids are taking? Are your kids in math? You know, did they take math this semester? How are they doing? The California math law is being set up to remove courses like calculus from black communities, right? So they're trying to enforce this in places like Oakland. We know for a fact that if this law passes in California, everyone else will pick it up. It'll penetrate to places like Newark, New Jersey, where I'm from. It'll penetrate into cities like DC. The thought process is black kids don't take math. Did anybody here take math? Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
So, we take math. Some of us even take calculus. So,
yeah.
And they said, we don't take it. And the bottom line is, if we don't take calculus, if we don't take some of the advanced maths, then we'll never even be able to be accepted into these programs. And it's very, very rare that you get a student that goes to college, studies 2 years in general studies, and then transitions into technology. Most of us are leaving it. We're not going into it. So we have to get them to go into it. So we need our kids taking math, we need them studying, and we need them to also understand, I'm serious, you don't have to get an A in it. I just need you to pass it. Mm. I'm so serious, I'm so tired of these counselors and everyone telling everybody that you have to make an A. I'm a BC math student, and worked out for me. I'm doing real good, okay? And I didn't fail my classes. I just wasn't super, super great at math, but I'm a very, very good business leader and I'm a really good tech leader. And, you know, calculus is what it is. Get through it, move on, and go on. And you have someone that looks like them has to tell them this. They have to know that they can be okay even with the B or the C in the math, and that that is not the giving up rights. And you need to tell the parents that too, because they're only listening to what the guidance counselors are telling them. The same guidance counselor that told my parents, we're raising the future of, I went to an all-girls boarding school, you know, on a voucher. And they told my parents, we're building the future of women. And then they told my parents I couldn't study engineering. And my father was like, well, I'm confused, because you just said 4 years ago that you were building the future of women. So this is what parents are hearing. If my cousin hadn't told my parents that she could still study engineering, who my parents, by the way, didn't even know what engineering was. But fortunately, my cousin was studying engineering. And so I'm saying this because you've got to tell your younger generations, and it's super important. If they have an interest, at this point, even if they don't have an interest, if you have the authority over them, i.e. they don't pay rent, they don't buy toilet paper, then you get to tell them what to do. Put them in our summer engineering program. Put them in the SEEK program. Let them spend 3 weeks with folks that are teaching them about technology. Our curriculum only teaches black tech. So everything you learn when you're in a SEEK program is what black people invented. And we still can't get through it in 3 weeks, because that's how dope we are. And so have them join one of our programs. We also do a program virtually, because we know that everyone can't make it. But when they come to SEEK, we're feeding them, they're learning, these kids are flying drones, building stuff. They're being taught by black people, black students, black teachers that take their summers and spend it with us, and they are paid. It's not that they're working for free. And this is how they get exposed to this program. If you have students that are in it and you can afford it, offer to pay for their books. You're like, you know, I'll cover your books for the semester. I'll buy one book. It's expensive to study tech, and a lot of times they just don't have the funding. Our students that are studying tech, and even if they're not NSBE members, black students, when we give them scholarships, we do not give the scholarships to the universities. We give it to them directly. And I tell anyone that funds NSBE, if you do not want us to work like that, then you'll have to keep your money. Because when we put money into the university directly, it impacts their financial aid. And they need the money. Sometimes they need it for school. Sometimes they just need it to get home. Sometimes they need it to fill up that grocery bag that's just full of their clothes because they don't have a suitcase. These students are brilliant, but some of them are still from the hood. Not all of them, but some of them. And so it's very important that we not take away from what the school is giving them, so we fund them directly. And they need other people that will do the same. If your university will not allow you to give a scholarship, I have someone that recently wanted to start a scholarship at their PWI for a black student, and the school told them that they couldn't be racially specific with their scholarship. And that's not true, but I was gonna say something else. That's not true. And so I said, well, give me the money. You can tell me down to, like, you want box braids, you want single knot, like, what do you want me to give this, who do you want me to give this money to? They have to have a fade, locks, you name it, we can find the student that needs the help, and you can get that specific with us. And so we're trying to meet the needs of our community, and I'm very, very clear that the Black STEM experience is uniquely different to any other organization. And so while membership at NSBE may also mean that you're a member of the Society of Women Engineers or DevColor or other organizations, I'm very clear and very specific that the things that are required for our students are uniquely different, and we highlight that. And for however long I'm in this role, which is a window of time, I came here to do something very specific for NSBE, then that's the voice that I'll have, that's the mission that I'll push, and these are the things that I'll try to bring to the forefront so that we can make an impact, and hopefully it will live long after me. One of you should come and run NSBE when I'm gone, because I need to retire. So talk to me over there later.
Wow. You know, I think the one thing I want to also highlight for these folks in here, because a lot of people here are looking to develop in their careers, right? And so you all have, you know, a lot of tools that you, and programs and workshops, and you've mentioned a little bit of those. What are some things that you all are sort of have that people can take advantage of as members of NSBE to help with their professional development?
Well, if you've never been to a NSBE conference, then I would strongly encourage you to join us in March. We'll be in Atlanta, March 20th to the 23rd, at the Georgia World Congress Center. We're anticipating about 15,000 people. Probably about 10,000 of those will be students and professionals, and the others will be corporations, companies. I can tell you that while the majority of our membership is collegiate, there is a lot of work and a lot of opportunities for professionals like yourself. And so if you're seeking a role, it's a great place to work the convention floor. They interview on the spot, they give jobs on the spot. So there's great opportunity there. If you can't make it to Atlanta, if you're a member of NSBE, then we do have a career center that's online. You can search for jobs online. You can post your resume online. It works if you work it, because you know folks come to us and they're looking for roles. Because our partners pay a one-time annual membership fee, they want access to talent that is actually going to be easier to access than maybe going through a hiring firm or something like that. So there's a ton of opportunity for professionals like yourself, and we don't always get that volume of people because the majority of our membership is collegiate. And so there's a great space for people like yourself if you're looking. And I just think that it's just a community where you can just find your tribe and find a place to exist just like you find right here.
I was told we have a few more minutes left, and I want to ask you, just on a personal note, what has been one of your biggest, what do you feel like has been one of your biggest accomplishments in your career?
I think before I went to Wiki, I thought that it was, and actually still is, when I worked at GE, the work that we did in handheld ultrasound was an epic fail the first round. As a technologist, we made a lot of mistakes, and we spent a lot of time humbling ourselves to get it right. And I think that humility is like a core attribute for a great technologist, because we had to admit what we did wrong, and then we rebuilt it. And to see version 4 and 5 of a product that I was a part of designing with a group of people is something that I couldn't be more proud of. Having taken that work and lived in Africa for years and just done such great work. I actually just got back from there last week for the Engineering World Congress, where we were talking about the impact of technology on socioeconomic issues in the world. And so to know that that still resonates is a value to me. But then I think the second thing is, and it's taken me some time, I just want to say this to the black women here, it's taken me like a lot of coaching with my PR and comms team to actually even be able to talk about things I'm proud about, because I was like, no, we just did a thing and it was cool.
Yeah.
And it helped some people. But we did a really, really dope thing, and it saved a lot of lives, and it made the corporation a lot of money, and it made me a lot of money because I fought for my patent. And so I just need to pause there and say that people will try to keep you out of the room when you're working on something that is patentable. And the takeaway here is that you have to be in the room the day the ink is on the paper for the design. Every other meeting after that is just work. Y'all just working really hard. The day they sign and say, this is an idea and it works, if your name is not on that paper, you don't get the patent. When you don't get a patent, you don't get residual money. Every time something happens on this product, cha-ching, I get money. And when that doesn't happen, they're in your pockets. And that is a miss on our part, because we don't know, and because they do everything they can to keep us out the room. So check that and make sure that your ideas, that your, you know, your name is on something. And then when we went over to Wiki and survived that, we worked at Wiki through the work of Black Lives Matter. And I, you know, they say during the downtroddenness of Black people, but that's today, so when it was at its peak at this particular time. And during that time, the Black Lives Matter page, we don't have enough time to talk about how Wiki works, but pages don't stay up unless they're monitored by certain people in the community that say they can stay up. And so wordsmithing is very important on encyclopedia. So fighting for George Floyd being dead or George Floyd being murdered is an actual thing that can go on and on and on and on and on. So getting those pages right and then getting them to stay up to perpetuity and not come down is a feat that I didn't do alone, but with these women and with other people that worked there. But we had to fight every single day to make sure that that could happen. And so to honor his family, to honor those that have lost their lives in just the most tragic of ways was something that I don't think that we'll ever forget, right?
Yeah.
And it just plays a major part in who we are today and in the social justice fight.
Wow. Give her a hand. Yeah. Yeah. I want to express gratitude for you, Janeen, for being here and sharing your story. You know, if no one has given you your flowers, I want to give you your flowers right now.
You.
I don't have any right now, but as the kids say, right? And so, you know, very, very great work, very great job. And you're someone who inspires me. I am an operations, you know, lead. And so, you know, seeing you as the first CEO, COO of Wikipedia, and now the first CEO, not the first CEO of Wikipedia, but the first CEO of, you were, she was.
Yes.
Give her a hand again, right?
It was.
Come on. To see you here, it means the world to me. And to see us here on at Audi Field, guys, think about this, a Black technology conference. This is just amazing. I also want to say the importance of having strong leadership in the tech industry is so important, you know, and we want to encourage the audience to connect with NSBE. How can they stay connected with you?
So you can connect with NSBE at nsbe.org. You can certainly connect with us also on LinkedIn. You can find me there as well. And, you know, we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to be in touch. I try to be as available as possible. This is mission work for me. This is my social justice movement. I'm kind of a keys to the keyboard fight. And, you know, so it's important to me. I would encourage y'all not to be afraid to do the first stuff. When you do stuff and you're the first, it doesn't always get credit until it's way over. So years later, people might be like, oh yeah. But it sets the path, and if you're okay with not necessarily getting the credit for it always, but if you're strong enough to take the licks, then we need people like us to be the first in some of this, because I'll be very honest with you, most of the time people don't want to do this work. It's grimy, but if we don't do it, the challenges that we're going to have in tech in the world are going to be even worse, and I want to convict us to be able to say that some of that's going to be on us. If we don't get out here and do this, it's on us. I had someone say to me, and I thought this was a little Harriet Tubman-ish, but he was a preacher, and he said, I would reckon the black movement in technology of today to be in line with what the black vote meant to our ancestors years ago.
Yeah.
And so I think we should just leave it there and let that kind of settle in us. And that's just how critical everyone in this room really is.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Y'all have a good day.
Let's give it one more time for Janeen Uzzell and Mike Howard. How'd y'all enjoy that conversation?